Hi, bro. You doing okay? Yeah? Everyone had coffee? Food? Good? Doing good? Okay, we can get started. My name is JamesRawlings. I work for Red Hat. I'm working as an engineer on the open source project Fabric8. Just a quick show of hands. How many people were with James's talk earlier? James was there, that's okay. Okay, well, that's good. So there may be a little bit of repetition of some part, but I think that's okay. All right, let's get stuck in. So times are changing. Certainly with the adoption of cloud, we've heard a lot about microservices, DevOps movement. A lot of people have been talking and explaining their experiences with these, and it's changing everything. It's changing the way we develop software. It's changing the way we design, build, release, manage, and maintain and run our software. And this has been going on for a couple of years now. I think with Docker, it came around, sorry, with containerization, the adoption, people are really starting to look at this. I think the last couple of years, people of more advanced companies have been looking to adopt these technologies, and other organizations have just been a little bit slower to try to work out, find out what the people's experiences are. But I guess if you take one thing from today, I guess I really would want to encourage you to go away, and if you're not already looking at containerization, if you're not looking at microservices, if you're not looking at cloud, hopefully you'll go away and try and start looking at it yourself. That's just one thing I'd really hope to give that impression. Okay, so what I want to really talk to you today is how we might be able to start taking advantage of these. How it's all very well and good talking about microservices, talking about DevOps, but how is an organization, how can you actually try and start to adopt these? It presents a lot of challenges. Including these challenges, we want to also, within our software, we want to be able to improve the quality. And we want to maintain quality as well, building quality into the software that we're building. Continually improving the quality that we're delivering. We want to decrease the time to market for our features. If I've got an idea as a product manager, I don't want to be waiting for a year for that feature to go into running in a live environment. A, I may have missed an opportunity, my competitors might have beaten me too. And to be honest, frankly, I wouldn't want to be betting potentially my career on a 12-month long wait to see if my feature actually worked or not, whether it's actually useful. People actually needed that. So we want to be able to decrease the time to market of our features. We want to then learn and understand how these features are being used, how we can then improve ourselves, improve the software, but also improving our processes within the company as well, or within our teams. So we need to be looking to decrease the time to market. We want to encourage innovation as well. We want to keep happy. As developers, we want to be innovative. Kind of nothing really kills innovation rather than being developing some code and then having to wait a year for it to actually be used. I can't even remember about the code I wrote last week, let alone 12 months ago. You want to be able to encourage innovation, and you want the best way to do that is to be able to deliver fast these features and then encourage innovation around this. Trying out new ideas. Not all ideas are going to work, so it's good to have these feedback loops to understand what is working and to encourage this innovation. So the clue was in the title. Everything's continuous these days. But continuous improvement is really, for me, is what makes me better. We want to be always looking at how we can improve. I'm always looking at myself, and things I do, the activities I do, wanting to understand how I can improve. Because they're never perfect. And things you have to be able to agile. Things don't always work the way they're intended to work either. So we want to be continually improving in the things we do. Not just the software, but also our processes, our experiences, the way we work. So has anybody looked at the DevOps, state of DevOps report? Okay, second thing I would totally encourage you to do, if I would It's actually, it's not a boring, really, it's a nice PDF, there's some real things stand out in there. Yeah, go and have a look at it, download it. It's just, it was a survey that by Chef, I think it was, Public. They did a survey of 20,000 professionals, IT professionals, wanting to understand their experiences around DevOps. And there were some very, very clever people that took that information and they analyzed it and they produced this report. It's a very short report, but it's really, really interesting. I've got two slides in here, really kind of stuck out for me. And this kind of blows my mind a little bit. High performing IT organizations have 60% fewer failures and recover 168 times faster. That's a high performing team. Or actually, what is a high performing team? They have actually given here their definition. High performing team is based on three metrics. It's the deployment frequency, so how often we're actually deploying code. It's our deployment lead time, which is how long does it take before we commit code so that it's actually been run successfully in a live environment. Two very, very different things. And also, mean time to recover, MTTR. These three metrics is what they believe is understanding how we can work out our high-performing teams. That's kind of interesting because it makes things easier because we can kind of start looking at the way we work, the way we deliver, the way we deploy. We can start understanding for ourselves how we are performing. Not every organization is the same, not every team is the same. So you want to be understanding what works in some teams and what may not work in other teams. What they've said is there are these four bullet points in this actual report of ways that you can actually achieve this. Writing better code quality, better testing, kind of makes sense, but you know, a lot of the time we don't actually do all of these things. Building actual testability and deployability in mind, and creating a culture of continuous improvement. It's the culture. That's the thing that helps us be able to get there. If you've got a very closed culture or then within your teams and your organizations, then it's going to be very, very hard to improve. For example, I've worked in companies before where you're not even allowed access to the version control systems of teams in the same company. So it's closed source, but it's closed team source within the same company. And there's no way to learn from each other then, sharing experiences. And it doesn't create the culture, the environment people want to share. You need to be learning from each other. And it's that culture that helps us improve. We want to learn. It can be really hard to adjust. I worked in a place where we introduced a code review tool. Well, the first 2 months of this code review tool running, then people didn't like it. People couldn't get on with it. People would be very tight about either reviewing people's changes or even receiving that feedback. But we had to change. It did change over time, the culture, to be more open and be more willing to receive feedback and better in giving feedback away. So these kind of things are fundamental in the organization if we're going to be able to improve. So it's all about feedback loops, continuously improving based on what we learn. We're doing this a lot already today. Who's doing continuous integration? One person, two, three, yeah, few people. Continuous integration is pretty much a given now in software development. It's expected people should all be doing continuous integration. Then there's continuous delivery or continuous deployments. We want to be automating the activities involved in taking our code actually through our environments so that we can test the quality and take out any of the manual tasks. Improving the time of our pipelines, increasing that time to market as well. So all of these are continuously require feedback. This is a good one I like, it's continuous experimentation. It's the idea of having an idea and not knowing if it's going to work or not. So you might be able to release that feature to maybe a certain select number of your customers, receive the feedback. But unless you've got the feedback loop, the established channels to be able to receive that feedback, who knows if it's going to work? I know a lot of things I do aren't actually ever being used in the way I intended them. You need to have that feedback by the people who are going to use it so that you can improve. So this is around continuous experimentation. So So what this we're doing already, with continuous integration, we want to be having code review tools, we have SonarQube, a lot of open source projects that help us be able to do this from our CI point of view. Reducing that time when things may go wrong, or we may be introducing something bad, we want that with continuous integration environment before our change gets merged into a master environment. So we want to be able to visualize this. How do we consume this information? What's that feedback? Again, we're kind of familiar with testing, you don't have to read it, but this is JVM test reports, again, continuous integration. Down here, we've actually got BDD. This is Serenity, another open source project. So it creates living documentation. It allows us to have automated testing and creating acceptance tests before and with the it describes how our features, the behavior of our features are working. And these are all really, really important things. Again, open source tools help us be able to achieve this. We said about feedback, how are things actually working? By that, we're actually working on an open source project, which is fantastic. Being able to openly go out and to develop, also receiving the feedback from issue trackers. And I don't know how many organizations actually have those feedback loops, right through from their customer base to the engineering teams. We're very lucky with open source to do that. I know a lot of organizations don't actually have the culture or actually make it very hard for people to get that feedback, which is kind of crazy. So we also want to automate a lot of this feedback as well. These established channels. So we want to be able to be notified. We don't want to always look at a test report that's green. We want to be to know about when a test report maybe needs attention. We want to be notified when things happen. We don't want to have to go always looking for things. So we can automate a lot of these things. This is just a screenshot of a few bots. This is a bot that's going out and talking back to social channels like Slack and IRC. We want to be able to have this information sent back to us and automating as much as possible. So with me? So how does Fabric8 get into all this? This is the thing. We've looked at these areas and we kind of looked at the open source projects to help us within these kind of areas. To be able to continually improve, we looked at these kind of areas that we want to be using. Lots of fancy transitions. Open source software is just evolving. It's just a great time to be working in open source software. All these amazing projects are just open source except for Slack. But we wanted to look at what we can integrate with to be able to help that developer experience, to help that maintaining, building, and running the experience on the platform. Because to be able to write code and have that running on the live environment, you need to do a lot of things. And these projects, they're designed specifically to be able to help with these things. They're the best of breed. I'm not saying these are the only ones we can integrate with, we want to integrate with, but they are the best at what they do. With Kubernetes, with Docker, Jenkins, we've heard a couple of talks about Jenkins, code reviews, chat, and at the top there, we've got Grafana, Kibana. This is a way how we can analyze information so we can continue to improve. So Fabric8 pulls all these things together. We actually, it's a set of microservices itself that is developed and is run on top of Kubernetes infrastructure. So we can actually start integrating. We want to automatically wire all of these things together so that the user experience from a developer's point of view or a maintenance or a DevOps engineer or somebody is actually using this platform. All these activities involved in creating everything or wiring things up, we want to take care of all of that. So basically, people are there just developing and delivering value faster. That's kind of where Fabric8 is in this. So for those of you who don't know, so this is for, we talk about openness. We want to be encouraging around centralized logs. So centralized logs, the leaders in the industry for open source project, the Elasticsearch, allows us to help perform powerful queries across our logs. To be able to visualize this, we use that. so that we can actually go in and find out where things are, get the information about our applications and how they're working. I've again worked in so many places that actually won't allow developers to access logs. Which kind of seems a bit crazy, right? Yeah, we're developing things, which we need to be able to support and correct and fix and evolve and improve, but yet we're not actually allowed to understand how things are actually working. We need to be encouraging around centralized logs. Similarly, centralized metrics. When things are going wrong, we want to be informed and we want to understand if we introduce a change, whether that's a spike in memory, whether that's an impact on CPU. We want to understand trends as well, how things are working, over what time. So we get this valuable information, gives us the feedback we need to be improving our software. So, with that in mind, I've cheated a little bit. I've recorded a demo to kind of show us, try and explain a little bit better how we're integrating and how we want people to use these. Fabric8 in the platform itself, I hope people go away and have a look at it. It's a VM that people can actually do a simple baby lab, you can do it now. And it will actually prepare everything for you that we can show on this demo right now. So there's only a couple of 30 minutes left. Okay, I'll go a bit slow, because I think it's only 13 minutes, so maybe lots of questions afterwards. There was only a couple of hands, so maybe I'll explain a little bit more about this. Fabric8, as I said, second one of the services, running on top of Kubernetes-based platforms. So I'm actually running on Google's container engine, GKE. We've installed Fabric8 using a very one-line command, and that's actually then provisioned our tooling that we've shown before in the lots of open source projects. We've wired them all together. So everything is running. You don't have to set anything up. This is a console. At the top here, we can see it is our team. It's a little bit smaller than the toilet size here.
We've got... Yeah. Do you want to drag the... drag the player.
Is it going?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you.
Oh, I didn't know. All right, so what we're looking at here is the Fabric8 console. We've got a team here, team default, which we have a better name than that. We've also got some environments that have been automatically created on Kubernetes. So we've got a testing, staging, and production environment that's automatically created. We've already run the continuous delivery pipeline feature. This is Nexus, and we want to be stored in our artifact when we build them. It's a Gulch repository, which is Git hosting. We've got Docker registry, and we've got Jenkins, all wired together so they can work together. One click is all we need to do this. This is what we need to be able to build our software. So now we can go and start creating some projects. For that, I wanted to show you how we run our metrics, our centralized logging and our centralized metrics. It's a one click from the Fabric8 console. That will actually instruct Kubernetes how, what the images, Docker images to pull down and how to run the metrics. It will also all configure it to ensure that the metrics is pulling in the right information so that we can actually visualize this, as well as the centralized logging. So it's just one click setup of everything, which is what we're trying to get to for high levels of automation. So, I'm not going to go too much into Kubernetes-specific terms. I just really wanted to highlight the ease and use of actually working and using these Kubernetes from a developer's point of view. So that's actually just run. We've told Kubernetes to run Elasticsearch, Gulch, Compiler. This is all happening on Google Container Engine. It's a really, really easy to spin this up as well. And it's three node clusters, and we've got a nice environment here. And we can see that that's actually now run Kibana, Gogs, Prometheus, Kibana, Grafana, Prometheus, and Elasticsearch. We can, again, what Kubernetes and Google Container Engine is actually doing is it's automatically giving us the setting up load balancer for us too. I think I just had to wait to advertise, it takes a little time. So just after clicking the run button, we can now, after a little time, I know it's going to be there, so there we go. This is the farm. Now, I don't know if FM budget was set up for final before. I did in a previous lifetime. It was, I found it quite hard. And also setting up all the little other bits, like SASB and various other paths. But this is one click. We've enabled people to be able to start getting centralized metrics from our platform. So you can see the total memory across the cluster, across the VMs. We can go and look at the pods. These are the term, Kubernetes term. These are our imaging, our applications that are running in the pods. So we can look at the memory on the left-hand side, as well as the CPU. So we can get real deep understanding of how our applications, our software is actually performing. We can go down here. Does anybody have centralized metrics, or everyone have monitoring set up at the moment? Nobody? Does this seem interesting? Would you see benefit from this? This is, I find it quite funny. Now that it's here, it's actually, now that we have centralized logs and centralized metrics, I kind of find it hard. We never even had this before. We weren't using this before. Because you want to be as early as possible understanding, getting that feedback if you've introduced a change, CPU, memory spikes, impacting other services. You want to have that in a test environment. You don't want it in a production environment. You need to have it as soon as possible. Get that bit of feedback. So now we have centralized logs and centralized metrics. Everything is going on in our platform. This is Kibana. We've actually created some dashboards already with Fabric8. So the image that we run, you can have access to these dashboards already for the centralized logs, powerful search. We also have some other dashboards which I'll show in a second. You can also extend these and add your own as well. This is just to get people started. I must admit, it was a bit of a learning experience creating charts with Kibana. But you kind of get used to it. It's helpful if this is charts to start you off. So what we're going to do now, we've got our centralized logs and centralized metrics. We're going to build some software. We're going to create an app, a few apps, and run them on the platform. We're going to start off with a Vertex app using the Fabric8 quick starts. This is a Vertex app, which is going to have a HTTP endpoint. Something really simple, but we want to be able to build this and have our continuous delivery pipeline, which we're selecting now, to stage it and wait for approval after we checked it so that we can then promote it into a production environment. Before we promote it into a production environment, we're going to look at the health. We're going to look at how it's performing within our staging environments. But we're also not just one app, we want to have multiple projects. So once this one's actually going off, that's a new Vertex app. We go back to our create project, again, all through Fabric8 console. This is what you get by installing Fabric8 on top of the Kubernetes or the chip. We're going to try a wildfire swarm. I don't actually know what I'm doing yet, but I'm doing this, I'll be honest. But we just want to try out different options. We want to be looking at different languages as well, how they perform, how we can compare the two together. What they're doing is kind of apples and pears. I just wanted to give them the impression about having whether multiple applications in an environment we need to compare memory and CPU. So we're going to use the standard continuous delivery pipeline we've got. This is Jenkins under the hood, is now going to build this and run it through this pipeline using the Jenkins pipeline plugin. That's all part of Jenkins too. You can see now back in Grafana, we should soon be having some metrics that we can see. Because we started using the platform, Jenkins is actually doing some work. Memory consumption has started going up, there's lots of build pods going. And Jenkins in itself. One of the things I would want to say, for Java developers, I don't know if you're not having metrics or monitoring, I don't know if you know how much memory it actually uses compared to other languages. Java is quite heavy for memory usage. So we need to be careful, we need to understand what we're developing and what it's consuming. It's very easy to have a high consumption of memory in Java. You just need to be understanding earlier where this is, where this happening. So lastly, we did a Vertex app, we did a wildfire swarm app. I've tinkered with this example slightly, it's going to fail. There's a reason I wanted it to fail, honestly. But this is a camel app, and this is going to create a our CD pipeline is going to create our Java camel application. It's going to build it into a Docker image, it's going to push it into a registry, and it's going to then promote, start deploying it into our environments. If we go back to our dashboard now, you can imagine that we want to be having many, many of these applications, hundreds, thousands of applications. So being able to visualize and understand from our teams, as well as our environments, is pretty important. What we can see now is we've run through an integration test environment, we've had successful results, it's now deployed into a staging environment. We can see we've got links here now, we can look at the docs that we generated, automatically generating, and additional ones with content repository. If you're introducing continuous delivery, be able to approve promotion, you need to be able to understand what's in that change. You want to be generating automatic release notes. And those changes, that those reports, test reports, BDD, living documentation, needs to accompany that change. You can make well-educated decisions about promoting into environment. We want to be reducing the approval time rate as much as possible. Really, ideally, no approvals at all. So if we look in the last 5 minutes, this is our Vertex app. It's kind of hard to see. You've got the CPU on the right, the memory on the left. It's about 143, it's the name of the RAM there being used, and you can see there's a spike when we first started. We can go and have a look at the app. This is our Vertex quick start that we've got running in the environment, so we can access it, we can check if it's actually there, running, before we actually promote it. Everything looks good, we're happy, gets promoted into the right environment. So we have a continuous delivery pipeline that's been given by the platform. It's helped us build and develop and promote our software. We look back at our wildfire storm. Now, I don't know, maybe it was just the time of day. I think this example, I've just sped this up. It took about 4 or 5 minutes, I think it was to put down a lot of dependencies, which is sped up a little bit. But this is this is where it's putting and building a the application. So we're generally doing it, performing, making release on this. We'll build the artifacts and push them into, deploy them into Nexus repository before we turn it into a Docker image using tooling and fabricated. Helps us easily build these Docker images and then generate resources to be able to run on the Kubernetes platform. So we can see here, just sped it up, and this is deployed. The interesting thing is, this is a Vertex app, Wildfire Swarm, Node.js, Ruby, all of those other quick starts that we had. We're building and deploying them and testing them in a consistent way, which is kind of doing something to help a consistent way of working within our teams and our organizations. It's going to help us be able to adapt and work with different projects, having a consistent way to build, test, and release software. So this example here, I think if we refresh the file, we should have our second pod in our staging environment. We select our namespace. This is our namespace in the environment. This is where we switch over to see our pods. We've got two pods now running. Our pods are our applications, a Wildfire Swarm pod, and we've got a Vertex pod. You can see the Wildfire Swarm, actually, it's not actually doing, you know, it doesn't really necessarily matter what it's doing. You can actually see the memory consumption and the CPU consumption. You can actually compare them against the Vertex. You probably be doing similar kind of things, maybe, but it's kind of starting to get quite interesting. You can compare different, you know, features and functionality in different languages as well, or different, using different languages as well. So we can see that quite, we can see that actually working and operating quite differently. From our CD pipeline point of view, we actually opened up the link. I didn't know what I was actually selecting there, it's actually forbidden, it doesn't look healthy. So at this point, we're actually going to report this change. We're not happy with our environment. So that's aborted. That change never made it to production. We go back to our apps, we can see now we've got our dashboard, we've got some large donuts, everyone likes donuts. You can see we've got a production environment, this is where we promoted our Vertex app, but our Wildfire, our staging environment has two in there that we aborted the. Now, this is our, it was pre-planned, it was just me tinkering, but this is our CAM application. That actually failed. It failed in the pipeline. So what we can actually do, we want to have information. In fact, I want to understand everything about my continuous delivery pipelines within my teams. I'm going to have hundreds of thousands of these pipelines running. So I want to be able to visualize and analyze this information. So I want to know the number of deployments, remembering how we measure we want to be high performance teams. We want to be measuring the number of deployments per application, the number of builds as well, how active and how many builds are we actually performing. We also want to be understanding from how successful or how what the quality of our pipelines are as well. So you can see down here, I think we're actually looking at the builds per application here. We see those are the three builds that we went through. This is our build pie chart. So we have one failure, which is our camel. We aborted one, and the green one at the bottom here, that's our vertex. That was our successful pipeline. Again, we want to be getting a lot of information. This is the feedback to understand how we can improve. We've got the logs in the environment. You can see that one application is actually producing a lot of logs within the cluster. That's actually Fabric8 Forge, 15 minutes. That's the Fabric8 Forge one. I think we need to turn down our logging a little bit there. You know, the application is producing, generating a lot of unnecessary logs. You want to know about it. Again, it's kind of these wide areas that we need to understand how our application is performing. And this is a really good one here for me. This is our approval wait time. We've generated all of this completely out of the box from our continuous deployment pipelines. I want to understand, I'll just pause this. I want to understand from within my pipelines any approval stage, how it's taking, if it's taking particularly long time. Because that's going to flag up potential issues within processes, within the organisation. It might be on one chapter and actually approve it, and maybe on holiday for 2 weeks. There's understanding of how we want to be taking our software as fast as possible to running in a live environment. But if there's stuck waiting for approval, that's an interesting piece. And you want to understand what those activities are, looking at how we can improve them, maybe automate more of them, and shorten that time to market. So this is from a Fabric8 point of view, this is what we are producing and generating, working with the likes of Docker, Kubernetes, Jenkins, Hubot, Elasticsearch, Prometheus, Grafana, or this goes on. And we continue with best of breed, test performance around BPD, automating as much as possible so that people from the developer's point of view, from the team, from the organization, is getting and achieving value faster. That was it. I think I've got one last slide up, which was, by the way, did anybody try and give that a go and try and download it? If you were going to go to Fabric8, you can go to Fabric8.io, it's a getting started page. And links through to some favorite images that you can pull down. Or if you have access to container images or OpenShift instance yourself, you can actually run this. Just to finish off, the technology is the easy bit though. It's understanding how we can change the culture in our organizations, within our teams, to be more open and want to improve. So the first bit is getting the technology, but you need to be involving the right people at the right times as early as possible so that you have more chance of being able to achieve these continuous improvement. And that's it. For more information, there's some blogs. They're really active. There's a good Fabric8 community that's actually really active about producing logs. Yeah, check it out. Thank you. Any questions? No, good. Oh, yes, sir.
I have one question. So, do you see that most of the majority are on the same memory?
Yes.
But yeah. In our case, we are most of the detection errors or faults and so on. And do I have to manage this kind of thing? Like,
yeah.
Happy management or this kind of stuff?
Yeah. I mean, the examples I just showed there were CPU and memory. In fact, I've actually got the cluster running. We've I can actually look at this. I'll just show you. Out of the box, Prometheus is going off and discovering the metrics to display. So to consume, it actually scrapes these metrics. So if I look at, we actually out of the box by running the application, Prometheus has gone off to the HTTP proxy and it's looking at HTTP request as well. So we can actually visualize this. This is actually our camel routes. This is actually running in a live environment at the moment. This is actually the processing time of a camel application that's actually being deployed. So we can also see the camel changes within that environment, how to have understanding how applications perform. It's not just memory or CPU, it's any metrics that your application would offer up to be exported, that we will export. And out of the box as well, for Java, we actually, Roman, was it Agent Bonds, is it? The, yeah. So maybe explain about Agent Bonds just a quick one-liner.
Yeah, it's an agent which includes the documents and other agent which supports certain metrics, and all of the Windows GenX export is included. So if you're using our base images, it's Java, you have an easy way to export those metrics to replicate.
So out of the box metrics for Java applications. So yeah, absolutely, it's just from an example point of view there. You want to be setting up alerts as well. Media should be set up alerts, and you want to be notified of any so you can actually address that. So
you have a set of tools there, but if you want to use a different tool, how easy is it, for example, to change one?
Yeah.
You look at it by another option.
Yes, so it's a good question. The question is, how easy is it to swap out? So say we've got Nexus there, you might want to talk about an artifact here. They're all discrete applications, so we can actually swap any of them out. The things we're pretty reliant on are Kubernetes, and at the moment Jenkins as well, because we're actually using the Jenkins pod drive for continuous delivery. It's not to say that if you have other CI servers, you would still be able to integrate with those and have your pod drive actually triggering your builds from CI systems. But absolutely, we actually, those are the best of breed that we've identified. I think this time last year, there was a chap that, from Cisco, I think it was, and said, I like Nexus, but how? I want Artifactory. I think within half an hour, we release an Artifactory application. It's very easy to be able to create these applications and then interchange them as well. That's the other reason. We're very motivated to be able to allow people to chop and change whatever suits their needs. Okay.